reaction curve approach to Cournot's equilibrium. It is a more powerful method of analyzing Cournot's equilibrium. It allows for the relaxation of the assumptions of costless production, identical cost, and identical demand. Cournot's model explained that the two firms under duopoly will reach equilibrium, but it did not explain how would the firm reach that equilibrium. This reaction curve approach is based on Stackelberg's indifference curve analysis, which uses isoprofit curves of the competitor firms. Now, what is an isoprofit curve? Isoprofit curve belongs to the family of indifference curve, and isoprofit curve shows the combination of two inputs or two variables that gives the firm the same level of profit. The same idea of isoprofit curve can be used to explain duopoly. In the case of duopoly, it can depict combinations of output levels of two firms on two axes, and this will give constant level of profit to one of the firms. Let's assume we have two firms, firm A and B, and both firms produce some quantity of output. The question is, what will be that level of output that firm A should produce to get in the maximum amount of profit, and what should be the quantity of output that firm B should produce to get its maximum amount of profit. Now, the combination of firm A's and B's output only can decide the profit levels of both the firms. Individual output levels cannot decide the profit of the firm, unlike the other firm models of perfect competition or under the monopoly or monopolistic market. Here, the output of both the firms have to be considered before we decide what will be the profit of one of the firms. Now, isoprofit curve can be drawn this way. On the vertical axis QB, we show the output of firm Q, the firm B, and on the horizontal axis, we have the output of firm A. Isoprofit curve 1, 2, and 3. These are three isoprofit curves showing the profit for the curve at different levels of output. Different levels of profit based on different levels of output of firm A and B. This is for firm A. And then we can see, now we want to know what happens if a firm B changes its level of output. Will it change the profit levels of firm A? Now, to do this, what we need to introduce is a line which cuts through the isoprofit curve of firm A, which is A1. So we take a single isoprofit curve A1 and we introduce a parallel line which is horizontal to the firm A's axis. What happens here? When the line is intersecting the isoprofit curve 1, we see that it is intersecting at point G and H, and the firm may produce AH amount of output, or the firm may produce AG amount of profit. So let us assume that firm continues to produce with AG level of output or AH level of output. That profit is given here without a change. B's output is B1 and AA's output is AH or AG. So it is if it is at AG, it is expanding the use of its capacity utilization, or if it is AH, it is reducing its cost of production. So one of them may be true. Now, the question arises only when firm B changes its output. What if firm B changes its output from B1 to B2? Now, when firm increases its output from B1 to B2, then the firm will have to reduce its output if it wants to be in the same level of profit, because if the output of firm A, B has already increased and B remains at a higher output level, then the market will get depressed and firm A will lose its profit. So there is no point in staying at the same point, and firm A may choose to reduce its output, like we see in the diagram. From AG, the firm may reduce to AF level of output. Now, what the next question is, what will happen to firm A's level of profit if firm B raises its output to BE? Now, BE gives the firm A the maximum that it can get as profit is point E, and that is AE level of output. So firm B, if it increases its output to BE, then firm A will further reduce its output to AE and reach at its maximum of AE level, AE or E level of profit. So up to the point E, the firm must react. It is, there's no way the firm can stay away from that. The firm A must react to the increases in B's output by reducing its own level of production. So as the firm A reduces its production, the cost of production will change, but the net profit, that is the revenue minus cost, may remain the same, and therefore the firm remains at the same isoprofit curve. Now, let us introduce another isoprofit curve of firm A. In this particular case, we have introduced a profit curve A2. So just like how we did earlier, we are introducing a parallel line to intersect the new isoprofit curve. So when the new isoprofit curve is cut by the output B4, which the firm has gone up to, then it shows that the profit of the firm is at a lower level. We shall explain why the profit is at a lower level when the isoprofit curve is at a higher level. Now, to maximize the profit, there is a unique level of output that firm A must produce, given the quantity of firm B. So, given the quantity of B, there is a maximum quantity of output that firm A will produce. In the original Kono model also, we saw that when firm B produces a certain quantity, then the next stage, the B decides what is the quantity it should produce. So, once this kind of a shift was taking place between the two firms. So now we can understand that the profit, the highest point is the one that is available at point E, which is the lowest isoprofit curve for firm A. So the lowest point or lowest isoprofit gives the maximum profit for firm A, and this can be seen here. So at B4, the firm cannot reach a B4 level of output. With the same isoprofit curve, it goes to a higher isoprofit curve. So that means it is losing out now on making profit. To maximize output, it is the highest point on the lowest possible isoprofit curve of firm A. Now, closer the isoprofit curve is to the axis, the higher is the profit for the firm. If firm B produces beyond BE, a firm A will not be able to retain the same level of profit. Now, the firm can have three responses. Either it increases its output, decreases its output, or remains the same. In all the three situations, because B is now taking the action, firm A will definitely lose out on its levels of profit. So if it is constant, then the market price will fall and reduce its profit. If it increases or decreases, the fall in profit. So there will be increasing cost or increasing or decreasing increasing cost, and then the elasticity of demand will also alter. No matter what firm A does, firm A will earn lower profit if B increases its output beyond BE. Now, let us take the isoprofit curve of firm B. This is only the isoprofit curve. Now, the isoprofit curve of B, firm B is stacked towards the vertical axis. So we have isoprofit curve 1, 2 and 3 of firm B, which are facing the vertical axis or firm A's axis. And each of these isoprofit curve gives the firm the same level of profit with this given, with a certain combination of output of firm A and its response to in firm B. Now, let us see another new concept here, which is that of response curve. This is also called as a reaction curve because it shows how firm A will determine its output as a reaction to firm B's change in B output. So how will firm A behave to a change in B's output? So the diagram is a tool for understanding the duopoly models. So this response curve diagram and response curve idea is used later also, and therefore it is useful here for students to learn the concept well, because often the students leave this idea of reaction curves, and then it becomes difficult to understand the later models that come in. So this response curve is a locus of points of the highest profits that firm A can attain given the level of output of rival B. So if B's output is known, then how is firm A going to respond in terms of its what is its response in terms of profit? So when we get this position, we are talking about arriving at a reaction curve. Now let us look at the reaction curve. This diagram will explain to you. This is based on Kotsianis' modern microeconomics. The entire topic is for your reference. You can use Kotsianis' book. Now this reaction curve of a firm A is tacked towards the horizontal axis, because the A's output is shown on horizontal axis, and B's output will decide the profit of a firm A. So we have got firm the different levels of profit that you have got, 1, 2, 3 and 4, isoprofit curve, 1, 2, 3 and 4. So these different points of tendencies that we are seeing, if we connect these different points, we get what is called as the A's reaction curve. A's reaction curve is nothing but responding to B's output. How does firm A respond to B's output? So it shows how it will respond to that, and that to produce that certain level of output. Now you can take the reaction curve of firm B. In this particular case, the firm's curves are stacked towards the vertical axis, and the one that is closest to the axis is the best profit isoprofit curve for the for A. It is when the isoprofit curve is towards the closest to the axis, the lower axis. In the case of firm B, it is the closest to the vertical axis. So firm 1, isoprofit curve 1, is the most profitable position for firm B given the output of firm A. So when firm A is producing A1, then the maximum profit is for on isoprofit curve 1. So when we join these positions of the highest point on the low on each of these isoprofit curves, we get what is called as B's reaction curve. Now B will respond to changes made by A's output on its own profit. Therefore, it will change its own output to meet that, maintain or attain the same level of profit. Now, using these reaction curves, we have removed those isoprofit curves now. We only have the reaction curves. So there are two reaction curves. One is the firm's reaction curve, A's reaction curve, which is downwards, and B's reaction curve, which is upwards. So these two reaction curves are available now, and we juxtapose them or we intersect them at a point like E. Once we have got a point like E, we can see how the two firms are changing its output in such a way that they arrive at the point of equilibrium. So continuous adjustments will take place between the two firms, and both the firms want to make the maximum profit. So like how we saw in the original Cournot model, the output of half and half and the quarter that was left over. So the same process is happening here, but using the reaction curves and the arrow marks. You can see how the blue arrow marks are moving towards the axis, and the black arrow marks are also moving towards the quantity QE. So QE appears to be the equilibrium for a point for both the firm, but QE is not necessarily the best profit curve for the industry. So if A produces A1 lower than equilibrium output, firm B will react by producing B1. A1 produces, then the firm will react by B1. When B reacting B1, firm will keep it at A1. So reaction by firm A, more output to firm B, more output because of firm B's behavior, then assuming B will stay at B1, then again A will stay, and continuously both the firms are going to adjust their output till such time that they reach this point of equilibrium. The same thing that we did in Cournot's equilibrium in terms of numbers, that is here now shown in terms of the two reaction curves, and this adjustments will take place between the two firms, and finally it reaches the position of equilibrium. So adjustments will reach till the stable equilibrium output of QE is reached, but industry profit is not maximized. This is explained by another model, which is called the Edgeworth's contract curves later. So thank you very much, and please do subscribe and share this session. It will be helpful to me to make more videos for you. So thank you very much.